Again, he didn't just do it one time and leave me there because he knew that I would need him every day. Oh Jesus, we thank you, Lord, that you're a God who does it over and over and over. That you're a God that when we're in need, we can always come to you. This morning we have with us our brother Joseph Benjamin. He needs no more introduction than to know that he's a man of God who has been serving him and living for him, and has given himself, given his life over to God, and to spend the rest of his days making his life a blessing to others. He now desires to invest himself in others. So he does this ministry in Haiti. This is a ministry that we have given to. This is a ministry that we send. We have in our own small way that we have donated food to, for them to take to Haiti, and he's the head for that ministry here. He lives right here in town, but he goes back and forth to Haiti. He works for the school system here too, and he professes that the rest of his days is just to serve the people of Haiti.
Amen.
You know, that in itself is worthy of acclaim, but I tell you up front that Brother Joseph would not want to be praised for anything that he does. He just wants to be faithful to God and what God has invested in him.
Amen.
So our hearts connected a few years ago when I heard about this ministry. Because when we started out, we wanted to partner with people who were already doing. It makes no sense that I go and start something that somebody else is doing. So we want to partner with people, as many people who we can, as long as we know that these people are faithful to what God has called them to do. So without any further ado, help me to make welcome Brother Joseph Benjamin.
Thank you. I'll ask you. All God's people said,
Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. I tell you, with all this great worship and music, Pastor Green, I don't think I need to preach, because I don't need to teach, because in your prayer, you've already taught us this morning in your prayer, and there is such unity, according to Philippians chapter 2, in the prayer that you put before us this morning. And I am shaking. I am shaking up, because God does that. Jesus does that to us. Every time we stand before the throne of God, we are trembling.
Yes.
And then if you find a speaker or a teacher or a pastor who stand behind this pulpit and boast about anything, run. So good morning, church. Good morning, family. The Bible says, behold how good and pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. I am so blessed. Because the Bible says, where are two or three are gathered in his name, there also. As you're worshiping this morning, the words that coming out of those lyrics is sincerely. Listen, Jesus Christ started his ministry with 12.
Amen.
And he destroyed the whole world with the 12.
Amen.
Because one person can change the whole world. Amen. Because Jesus was that one person. And if we are truly the Jesus we claim to be, and the song that we just sung, if we are sincere and honest, I have news for you. So I invite you this morning, though my wife was supposed to be here, giving you a short report of all the work that you've done. And I know I am teaching to pastors. I often say to them that a false humility is arrogant. Mm-hmm. Someone who pretend that they are humble and meek, when in essence it's a cover. That's pride. That's arrogance. I'm not going to call my pastor, my brother, arrogant. But he says, the contribution that you gave was little. I have churches around here that promised thousands of dollars to our ministry. They have given nothing. My name is Joseph Benjamin, and I come from two parents of voodoo priests, which, and I am the youngest of 10 children. And then today, I am an ordained minister, not only glorifying God, living Jesus' life, but also preparing other ministers. Now that's a marvelous thing.
Amen.
So we find ourselves this morning, if you do not mind, turn your Bible to the book of Luke, the Gospel according to Luke. And we're going to look at chapter 4, and we'll take you starting on verse 18. Luke chapter 4. While you are looking for that verse, let me say thank you. Thank you, church, once again. Thank you, Pastor Green, for giving me this opportunity this morning. We have 15 or 20 minutes to close.
Yes.
All right. In that 15 and 20 minutes, we pray that the Lord will help us hate what he hates and love what he loves. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In the series of messages, Restore 2017, that we are teaching the whole year, that we already started in Haiti. Beginning of the month, we were there. So we come to teach this morning a message entitled Liberty or Freedom. Luke chapter 4, we're going to start on verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. The word of the Lord. What is that word Jesus talks about? Set something off. Liberty. There is another word. In fact, when I teach to men, I often ask them the question, what is one verb, just one word, that describes Jesus Christ's presence in this world? Why? What word, one word, Jesus Christ came to this earth to do? And that one word, and then they're shouting out in the audience, and usually like that, they talk about redeem in salvation. They say, well, I say, no, you're all wrong. The word is restoration.
Yes.
We sang it.
Yes.
And you prayed earlier about it. You did not know. But what is restoration? How do you define this word? Well, the world defines, I'm going to give you the definition of the world and then give you the definition of Jesus Christ. He says, since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. Romans chapter 1:20. And the word says restore. The verb restore is to bring back a previous right, practice, custom, or situation, to reinstate. For example, they say the government restored confidence in the housing market. And words we find that are synonymous with this word restore is reinstate, to bring back, to reinstitute, to reimpose, reinstall, reestablish. We find return someone or something to a former condition, place, or position. It says to, in other words, it says that repair or renovate a building, work of art, a vehicle. Well, this morning, my wife drove to the women's conference yesterday, and we said to come to church this morning, and then she just turned to the passenger side rear, back tire, and a big nail is pointing at it. So I'm looking at us, we have one vehicle. I say, how am I going to come to church this morning? How are we going to come to church? And when I say that, because when a holy thing cannot be touched by unclean hands.
Amen.
And I did not want him to bring me because I am coming to speak to God's people. And I do not want someone who's not walking with the Lord and to be in my company. And God knows that, but God makes all things beautiful in his own timing.
Amen.
He knows why he does that, because he knows my heart. My name is Joseph Benjamin, and I am found in the book of Genesis chapter 49. And this morning I'd like to share with you. See, the word restore is to repair, fix, mend, refurbish, recondition, rehabilitate, rebuild, reconstruct, remodel, overhaul, redevelop, renovate, and more. Why restore, though? Why restore? What does that mean? What needs to be restored? And who needs to be restored? In order to understand what Isaiah prophesied more than 1,000 years before Jesus Christ in the book of Isaiah chapter 61. How did the disciple understand what he was talking about? How did they receive that? Hence, to answer this question, we not only have to ask you to go back, but also to take you back to the original time. Well, yes, the beginning of time. In the book of Genesis, the question was asked as I preached to Haiti last month. I shared with them. And I asked them, why restored? Why? See, after God created the earth, he created mankind, he created Adam and Eve. The first question God came unto them and asked in the garden, what's up? Where are you? What's up? What's going on? What is it that I hear? What do I feel? What's going on? What's up? After Eve listened to Satan's voice, she disobeyed God and deceived her husband. The second time God was going to ask what's going on was when Cain and Abel had an exchange of attitude. And God said, the attitude of Abel I love, but the attitude of Cain I hate. Genesis chapter 3. For this reason, Cain jumped his brother and Abel and murdered him. He killed him. Therefore, God has asked a second time, what's going on? You see, started with those two first, what's going on, derive what is happening in humanity today, ladies and gentlemen. See, started with the time of Noah, Sodom and Gomorrah, the Tower of Babel, up until the captivity in Egypt, God has been asking what's going on. What's going on in your humanity? What's going on in a newspaper? What's going on in your world? What's going on? You look at the television, newspaper, books, or Facebook, what have you. You are driving on the road and you are asking, what's happening? What's going on? But all these things happening is all these things are happening because we do not do what God commands us to do. Everything you see in the world that you hate is just because we do not do what God commands us to do. You said, yes, why, how? Yes, what is surfing in your mind today? What is surfing in your mind? I know you go to the internet to surf, to look, but what is surfing in your mind? What is surfing in the brain God has given to you? The first machine ever created was this machine.
Amen.
What's surfing in it? What's going on in your morality? What's going on with your manhood? What's going on with your womanhood? I mean, there is no man, no women anymore in this world we're looking. You're looking at that young lady and then you talk to her and she says, oh, me, I'm not interested in men. I'm not interested to get married. I love women. And verse to verse, and that's what's going on. So the Bible, God is asking, what is happening? What's up? We are cowering. And this is why, in these last days, God is saying to read 2 Timothy chapter 3, Revelation chapter 14, and Romans 11 and 12. Read them to know what's going on. So the world defines liberty. When Jesus is speaking to the people, he says, I am coming here. I am here today to proclaim liberty. And the people looking at him, liberty, liberty? Don't you see Roman Empire all around us? Don't you see what's happening? What liberty are you talking about? So they say liberty is the state of being free from society, from oppressive restriction imposed by authority of one's way of life, behavior, or political views. In other words, that replaces liberty, you'll find independence, freedom, autonomy, sovereignty, self-governing, self-rule, self-determination, and more. The power of scope to act as one pleases. As one pleases.
That's the definition of the world. As we are Christian, we cannot act as we are pleased. Because we are doing the will of our Lord God Almighty. So the power of scope to act as one pleases. So that's why they understand the word liberty to be freedom, independence, free reign, license, self-determination, free will, or latitude. One should distinguish between the term freedom and liberty. Speaking generally, freedom usually means to be free from something, whereas liberty usually means to be free to do something. Although both refer to the quality of state of being free. So the restoration process in God's method, it is God's methods of making sinners righteous. First, we'll see how God changes a man's position. Then we'll see how he provides for a man's condition. Not only he dealt with the pardon of sin, guilt, but also of deliverance from sin's power. Whereas sin abound, grace did much more abound. Some have wanted to use this in other verses in the Bible just to prove that justification encourages sin. Far from it. They say that if a guilty sinner is declared righteous solely by faith and not by works, then let us do evil, that good may come. If the more heinous the sin, the more abundant the grace to pardon, then may we go on in sin, that the grace of God may be more magnified. Such was the slanderous accusation of the Judaizers, the Jews, made of Paul's teaching in Romans chapter 3. He defended the doctrine of justification against the charge that it encourages increasing sin in order to display grace more abundantly. This defense is the doctrine of sanctification. The truth is set forth perhaps more completely in Romans chapter 6 than anywhere else in Scripture. There are two divisions in the chapter, and both are introduced by a question which Paul answers with the firm statement, God forbid. God forbid that you will be saved from the wrath of God, of all the filthy things in this world, and you want to go back. It's like James is saying, it's you like a dog who actually returned to what it's already vomited. When you already been saved, you already born of Christ, you've been glorified, you've been sanctified, you regenerated. You are the hands and feet of Jesus Christ. So now here in Galatians chapter 6, Paul began his final words with the enduring term, brethren. Brothers and sisters in Christ. He uses this term 10 times in Galatia. Lovingly, he reminded that those who walk in the Spirit also need to express a loving concern for others. And then Pastor Green was praying on that this morning, to love our neighbors. If a fellow Christian inadvertently becomes involved in a fault, the Greek word here is paraptomati, means a false step. Those who walk in the Spirit will, in a gentle, loving way, seeks to restore him. Yes. And that's where we come in with the word restoration, and then to understand what restore means. You know, you need to restore each other. Restore a falling person. Restore someone who has overstepped. They are to remember, Paul warned, that they also are equally as vulnerable to temptation. 1 Corinthians 10:12. Believers are to treat the fellow man as lovingly as they would wish to be treated if they had fallen into sin.
Yes.
So Paul reminded the Galatians as to do other passage in the scripture that the evil one keeps on tempting those who are in Christ. This morning it was a temptation to us. First of all, my wife could not come here and told me I have to go home because she was so nauseated. And my flat tire, all these things is the work of the devil.
Yes.
But I am not going to let the devil take position over God's ownership.
No,
so this is that seeking to lead them to destruction. 1 Peter 5:8 says, Peter graphically described him as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. That's what the devil is there to do. And then that's why we have to be vigilant.
Yes.
So the Greek word for that is bastazete, means translate bear. It's a term which is often used to carry a heavy burden. Paul used to emphasize the responsibility of those who walk in the Spirit to bear the burden of those who are weak in faith. Romans 15:1. His word we call Jesus' loving invitation in Matthew 11. We have 5 minutes.
No, man. Take it down.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
But we are disciplined. As the Lord disciplined, we're going to wrap it up. At the Last Supper, Jesus told his disciple,
yes.
Listen, please. A new commandment I give to you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. John 13:34. The law of Christ means that the law of God has spoken and lived out by Jesus Christ.
Right.
Paul warned against the Christian comparing himself to fellow Christian. See, when you start comparing yourself with somebody else, that's pride and arrogance. Because the standard set before you is Jesus Christ himself.
Right.
Jesus Christ is the standard you measure in yourself every day to see, do I look like him? Am I getting there? But it's not comparing yourself with any other man, any other woman, or any other Christian.
No.
Paul warned against the Christian comparing himself to fellow Christian. This is the result of spiritual pride. Galatians 6:1. Bear and share the burdens. Brethren, if a man is overtaken by any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore. The word is restore. In Hebrews 13:19, but I specially urge you to do this, that I may be restored to you sooner. You know, as a professor and as an educator, I don't like to quote people because I know the Bible. See, everything that you can ever think of is in the Bible.
Yeah.
But I don't like to quote people. But Sister Teresa of Calcutta, India, said something. He said, let no one ever come to you without living better and happier. Be the living expression of God's kindness. Kindness in your face. Kindness in your eyes. Kindness in your smile. He says that life is an opportunity. Benefit from it. Life is a beauty. Admire it. Life is a dream. Realize it. Life is a challenge. Meet it. Life is a duty. Complete it. Life is a game. Play it. Life is a promise. Fulfill it. Life is a sorrow. Overcome it. Life is a song. Sing it. Life is a struggle. Accept it. Life is a tragedy. Confront it. He says, let it. Life is an adventure. Dare it. Life is luck, which I disagree. She said, make it. But life is too precious. Do not destroy it. Life is life. Fight for it. It wasn't pleasing enough for me. And she continues to say that there are people, ladies and gentlemen, often they're going to find you unreasonable and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people may accuse you of an ulterior motive. Be kind anyway. If you are honest, people may cheat you. Be honest anyway. If you find happiness, people may be jealous. Be happy anyway. The good you do today may be forgotten tomorrow. Be good anyway. Give the world the best that you have. And then even though it's never going to be enough, but give your best anyway. And she said, for you see, in the end, it's between you and God. It's never about them anyway.
Amen.
So today, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters in Christ, what I am inviting you to do today, it's time to let go. Let go and let God. Let go of anything that is bringing you down. Don't let any negative circumstances deter you from the wonderful things life has to offer. It's not worth it. So Matthew 9:18 says, you see a lot of people who do not know who Jesus is. You know, Matthew 19:18, Jesus restored the life of a woman. While he was speaking these things to them, behold, a ruler and the ruler came and worshiped him, saying, my daughter has just died, but come and lay your hands on her and she will live. Matthew 12:13, then he said to the man, stretch out your hands, as he stretched it out, and it was restored while whole. See, God will restore everything the enemy has stolen from you.
Amen.
I know we don't believe that. We said, we hear it. Jesus Christ is going to restore to you everything the enemy has stolen from you.
Yes.
God has given us, according to 2 Corinthians 5:18, which I am living, God has given us this ministry of restoring relationships.
Amen.
You said, how can you not restore your relationship with your son and your daughter? Because I surrender them to the Lord. And then the Lord is bigger than I am. He can do a better job. See, there's no greater power than to know that you surrender. We sing it, I surrender all.
Yes.
But we cannot surrender our husband and our wives and our children and our employers and our work. This is thou, the new. See, that new life leads to the realization that all things are of God.
Yes.
Nothing happens in this universe without God putting his hands on it.
Right.
And approving of it. And reconciliation especially is by his initiatives. Man's sin alienated him from his maker. Disobedience to God always brings distance in relationships.
That's it.
If you see any relationships being destroyed, the first question to ask, who is far away from God? That's what the good news is, that God has taken the initiative to restore fallen men to fellowship with him. If he had not, surely men would not. Indeed, you could not. A gracious God gives this message to us to share with mankind in a faithful ministry, which is diakonia service. That's where the word you find deacon, diakonia, where that service we are to serve. That's our ministry in Haiti. And then you are partnering, even though you're sitting here, you're serving in Haiti. Because see, what we are doing, we find reason and we to do our master's work. We do what our master tells us to do. And this is why you are partnering with us. So there are those who say, I'm almost done now. There are those who say, well, God has forgotten me. There is no turning back for me. I have gone too far. God does not allow you to turn. And today, I have news for you. Because there is a proverb that says that as long as you have a head, you should hope to wear a hat. Because he promised something that you need to understand. He promised that after you have suffered a little while, God will restore you, confirm you, strengthen you, and establish you. 1 Peter 5:10. And then he says in Isaiah 4:1-10, he says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you, and in my righteous hand. But you ask, Brother Benjamin, how can I be restored? What must I do to be restored? That the Bible says, Jesus says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. It's Romans chapter 10 verse 9. You see, he continues to say, well, I do not know all these things you are talking about, but Christ is our peace. He says, for when, see, Christ put Christ died in our place. So when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly.
Amen.
For scarcely for a righteous man, one will die. Yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were still yet sinners, Jesus died for us. See, that's what happened. Who himself bore our sin in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sin, might live righteously. By whose stripe you were healed. 1 Peter 2:24. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Romans 3:23. But hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah to the love of God. For in Psalm 71:20, the Bible says that though you have made me see troubles, many and bitter, you will restore my life again. From the depths of the earth, you will again bring me up. He says God can restore what is broken and change it into something amazing. All you need is faith. And that's Joel chapter 2 verse 25. See, we need to know that, for I will restore health to you. And I wish my wife had been here to hear the message of the Lord this morning. I will restore health to you and I will heal your wounds, says the Lord in Jeremiah 30:17. See, yes, God restore the broken.
Yes,
and so many of you says, well, I'm broken. But that's the business of Jesus Christ.
Right.
He's in the business to restore the broken one. As a matter of fact, if you've been whole, you don't need Jesus. He didn't come for the whole. He came for the broken.
Yes.
Because restoration is rebuilding all the broken pieces of yesterday.
Yes, that's it.
Today, if you find yourself whole, there is a song we usually sing when we were in Mission Haiti. Said, if you see me living today and chanting and dancing, it's nothing that I have done. It is the grace of God in me.
Yes.
It's the grace of God. So again, that is why his name is Jehovah Rapha. The restoration word is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. Jehovah is the existing one. Rapha is to restore, to heal. See, Jehovah is the great physician who heals the physical and emotional needs of his people. Exodus 15:26 and Isaiah 61:1. In a summary, the text that we just finished reading in Luke 4:18 is a summary of Isaiah 61 and Daniel chapter 9.
Yes.
If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, you know the verse. I will heal the land. I will help the people. So what's going on in your life? Why the world hasn't been restored? It is because we are not doing what God commands us to do. Because in Joel 2:25, we read earlier for you, and I will restore to you the years that the locust has eaten. A lot of you, locust has eaten your goods. And God will gonna restore that. But how does that happen? For those of you without hope, because you say, oh, there's no hope for me. Listen, in Genesis 20, he is the restorer of wives. In Genesis 40:13, he's the restorer of work and position. A lot of people are looking for jobs and stuff like that. Read Genesis 40 and 13, you'll see that. See, in Genesis 41:13, he's the restorer of office. In Genesis 42:25, he's the restorer of money. In Exodus 4:7, he's the restorer of wound and flesh. In Exodus 22:1, he's the restorer of stolen property. In Leviticus 6:4, he's the restorer of thieves. You know, I go to Haiti, and then a lot of people are trying to steal the money because we come from the United States. So we have a tree in the United States. You just shake the tree, and the money, dollars come out. So when you go to Haiti, the minute you walk through the airport, they start asking you until you leave the airport. So when you find yourself sitting in JetBlue, I say, oh, Lord, thank you. Thank you. You know, there's no place like home. Because every time, they're trying to steal everything you bring. So there's this man. He's a land inspector. Quickly, I'm going to give you the story. I went to him because our attorney in Haiti says that you need to see him because he's going to be able to do the land acquisition we're doing to build the hospital. He can help you out. And then as I was talking to him, and I mentioned to him that we have that prison ministry where we feed 225 inmates. And then we provide medication for them. We provide first aid and a lot of stuff. He says, you're wasting your money. And I said, well, we kill goats and turkey, and we feed them, and all that. He says, I would never even sell you a goat to feed people in prison. Because those people, I hate thieves. People who steal, who robs, I hate them. And I wish God would kill all of them. As a matter of fact, there was one of them who came to my house and stole my solar panel. And God knows I needed that. I want that solar panel. And then the thief came and stole it. I wanted him dead. Finally, when he get caught, he get to in the courthouse. And then I shoot out to him and I say, run. So that he couldn't get shot by the police. I said, run, run, stupid. You're going to go to jail for just a solar panel. Just run, run. And then that stupid, the fool he is, he tried to run. And they shot him. He didn't die. Then after that, I spent some time with that man. He's probably be in the late 60s, early mid-70s. And I said to that man, and I said, you a Christian? Yes, I'm a Baptist. I go to the church here. And I said, don't you understand that God designed, he's a designer. God probably designed you from before the beginning of this earth because you hate people who steal so that you will be a restorer of thieves. And he started crying. And his wife at his side, he was about to have a heart attack. I mean, to make an old man crying. And then I bring the gospel to him. And I say, you do not know the plan of God. See, that man you hate, you should love. Because God wants you to hate what he hates and love what he loves. Jesus Christ, God man, made himself a human being to come on earth to save that thief. That thief. And he starts crying. In Judges 11:13, he's the restorer of stolen lands. In Ruth 4, he's the restorer of life and nourisher of all age. In 1 Samuel, he's the restorer of cities and countries and the restorer of the oppressed. In Matthew 17:11, he's the restorer of all things. In Mark 3:5, he's the holistic restorer and restorer of life. In Mark 8, he's the restorer of sight. In Luke 19, he's the restorer of false accusation and restorer of fourfold. This morning you pray that God is going to abound and multiplies when he's going to restore you. But he's the restorer of fourfold. In John 21, he's the restorer of pastors. In Acts 1, he's the restorer of the kingdom of God. See, Acts 9, he's the restorer of Dorcas. In Galatians 6, he's the gentle restorer. And in Psalm, like you all know, he restores my soul.
Yes.
I pray God will restore everything the enemy has stolen from you. Your latter will be greater than your former. Because Romans 15:13 says, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may be abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit in Christ Jesus. be fully restored. In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.